Hello, dear students. I am Dr. T. Jaleja Nair, presently working at Government PG College, Kurud. Today, I am going to give you a lecture on Northrop Frye's function of criticism at the present time. It is prescribed for MA fourth semester, paper 1, critical theory, and it is in the unit 5. The article Function of Criticism at the Present Time was written by Northrop Frye in 1949. He was a great Canadian critic and is best known as one of the most important theorists of 20th century. He was born in July 1912 at Sherbrooke, Quebec, Canada. He had his education at University of Toronto. Later on, he worked as a professor of English at Victoria College at University of Toronto since 1939. He achieved international recognitions for his literary theories. Some of his major works are Fearful Symmetry, which is a work on the poetry of Blake. Another major work include Anatomy of Criticism, Myth and Metaphor, The Educated Imagination, Northrop Frye on Shakespeare. He died on January 23, 1991 at Toronto, Ontario. He wrote not only on Canadian literature and culture, but also on Christianity, on education, culture, and politics, etc. Now I'll just discuss the awards and recognition that he had received in his life. He was elected to the Royal Society of Canada in 1951. He was also awarded Lawn Peers Medal in 1958. Northrop Frye won Canada Council Molson Prize in 1971. He also won Royal Bank Award in 1978. Frye was also honored with a postage stamp in his name by the Government of Canada. Now let's come to the article Function of Criticism at the Present Time. Actually, this is an article. It was first published in 1949. Later on, it formed the basis of polemical introduction to his essay, collection of essay called Anatomy of Criticism. This article is mainly about the need of criticism and the role of critic and the future of criticism. And the article is mainly focused on defining his central theme, that is criticism. He wanted to define the need for literary criticism to distinguish the genuine literary criticism from other forms of criticism and differentiate between the direct experience of literature and the systematic study of literary criticism. According to Frye, the word criticism means the whole work of scholarship and taste concerned with literature. Frye intends to lay out a strong claim for how literary criticism should develop, and he attacked others for how they have developed instead. If we look at the context or the period when he wrote this essay, we'll find that he was writing this article in the decade after the Second World War, and it had two important consequences. One was the Cold War, which saw a rise in public interest in science and technological development, atomic bomb, etc. Science is associated with destruction. So he wanted to humanize sciences, and literary study is a central component of humanity. The second consequence was, it was a period when a large number of students, they entered university and college. So he wanted to evolve a method to teach the students. So he advocated new criticism, which focused on the close reading of texts. So in this article, we find he attempts to make a clear view of what is the function of criticism. Fry dismissed the parasitical view of criticism that thinks that criticism simply imitates or copies the literature it engages. Instead, he argues, criticism is essential for the understanding of literature. Without criticism, we would not be able to know about Shakespeare, for instance. It is criticism that directs our attention to the importance of Shakespeare and helps us to understand the thoughts that he had to offer for our civilization. Now, we'll study about what Fry wanted to say about the concept of criticism. He says that only criticism can speak because all other arts are dumb. He said this because he is not deliberately provocative in order to shake up our habitual ways of thinking. By dumb, Fry does not mean irrelevant. He only means that arts cannot give any account of themselves. They suggest rather than explain. But criticism is an expression of educated imagination that provides the language of organized perception. Here, he wants to say that it is criticism of a work of literature that explores the inner meaning and bring out every detail of the work. In this way, he wants to prove that criticism is very important, the role of criticism in literature. This kind of perception allows us to see who we really are and what we really want in consistent but always inspiring and inviting ways. Now, we'll come to his views on poetry and criticism. Fry points out that poetry is a disinterested use of words. It does not address a reader directly. He wanted independence of poetry from criticism as Sidney's declared independence from philosophy and history. He says, criticism is a structure of thought and knowledge existing in its own right with some measure of independence from literature it deals with. According to Fry, literature is a language and language provides means to express truth in its own right. Criticism for Fry is a subject of study with literature as its object. We can't learn literature directly, but we can learn how to interpret literature. Fry makes this comparison. I quote, criticism is to art what history is to action and philosophy to wisdom. It is a distinct mode of inquiry in the same way as history and philosophy. That means criticism is a knowledge about something rather than itself. Criticism also studies about the relation of among the different works of literature. Two things that he makes out about his view on literature is that he advocates the autonomy of literary study. He wants literature to be unique and separate. He wants to remind people of the fundamental importance of literary study, which has its own sphere of knowledge. He rejects literary study based on disciplines such as Marxism, which belongs to political economy, and psychoanalysis, which belongs to psychology. Next, we come to how Fry has discussed criticism as an autonomous field of knowledge. Like the new critics who advocated for the autonomy of literary work, Fry also advocates for the autonomy of literary study. This leads him to treat the most highly regarded critics in English tradition as mere readers, not genuine critics. The genuine critics are literary students of all kinds who make permanent contribution to our knowledge. His complaint about literary scholarship is only that it has stopped short of its potentiality. He revives the hope of a few coming generations that literary criticism may develop further. He gives up the conscious evaluative function of criticism, and yet believes that literary criticism establishes the canon of tradition and content of literary education without conscious evaluation of particular works. So in this lecture, we have come across what are Fry's views on criticism and what is the state of criticism during that period. So mainly he wanted that criticism should be an autonomous field of knowledge or autonomous discipline, which is independent of all other fields of study. So here I come to the end of this lecture. In the next lecture, we'll study about what are his views on critique. Thank you.